Good morning. And thank you, viewers, for tuning in on JSA TV and on Periscope. Welcome to Telecom Exchange CEO Roundtables, both for our guests here at Telecom Exchange as well as our virtual guests. We would like to thank our Wi-Fi sponsor, Transbeam, for making this happen here for us today. We appreciate that. And I love our Jeff Mucci, our RCR Wireless partner, friend. Now, our first panel here is Where Wireless and Wireline Meet, the trends, the technologies, the opportunities. We're going to discuss UC, small cell, and tower connectivity. As I mentioned, our moderator is the Jeff Mucci. He's the CEO and editorial director of RCR Wireless. He's also the managing partner of Arden Operating Company, owner of RCR Wireless News and Telecom Careers, a leading industry job board founded in 1999, before the bubble burst. Over the past 20 years, Jeff's been involved in many facets of running day-to-day operations for telecom, wireless, commercial, real estate, and energy services companies. So welcome, Jeff, and welcome to our esteemed panelists.
Thank you, Jamie. Thanks for having me here today. The topic is going to be where wireless and wireline meet. We're going to talk about some of the key trends. I'm delighted to have some key guests. We're down one man. Jay Lawrence is not going to be able to join us due to travel, but we have Hugh Shannon from Avotus, and we have Felipe Alvarez, CEO of Axiom Fiber Networks, and finally, we have Greg Weiner, partner of Vertix Consulting. Why don't we just take a minute, each of you introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about your companies.
Sure. Hugh Shannon, director of business development for Avotus. By way of background on myself, some personal detail, I started in telecom in 1981 when I was 10 years of age. But anyway, a long time ago. And right now with Avotus, Avotus is a company that basically has been in business for about 30 years. What we do is we provide companies with visibility and actionable business intelligence on the communication application usage. So that includes voice, mobility, unified communication applications. So we collect all that data, we run it through our proprietary technologies, and we can provide companies with insights into that data so that they can make better and more intelligent decisions on how to operate their environments, and obviously try to give them some guidance on how they can save costs for the services that they're using as well.
Felipe Alvarez, Axiom Fiber Networks. We are a telecom infrastructure provider in the New York City greater metro area. We're essentially a brand new startup company. Started putting fiber in the ground in October, launched the brand in January of this year, and we are pure and simple an infrastructure provider focused on dark fiber and custom networking solutions. This will be my third fiber build in the last 15 years in New York City, so stay tuned, because at some point it seems like the need for fiber always, at some point there's too much fiber in the ground, but in reality it doesn't seem to be, and I think some of the things we're going to talk about will drive to that point.
Good morning, Greg Weiner with Vertix Consulting. We're a small consulting firm. Typical management consulting type company providing services focused on the telecom space. A lot of wireless work, but as they've started to bleed over into the wireline side, we provide services to MSOs as well. You know, the breadth of our services is kind of typical to that of your larger consulting firms, but our focus is, of course, on telecom. So everything from acquisition due diligence to asset integration, business strategy, sourcing and outsourcing activities, and deployment program management work. So a fairly broad spectrum of services across the space.
Thank you. Again, my name is Jeff Mucci with RCR Wireless News. I always enjoy coming to this event each year for a couple reasons. One, it does give me a chance to talk with folks who are in the wireline or fiber infrastructure business, and RCR Wireless News is a publication. We cover the wireless industry, but with small cell densification and in-building wireless, these two worlds do collide. And when I first came to this event 3 years ago, it was like old home week. My background, I was early in my career with Metropolitan Fiber Systems, MFS, They bought a company I was with and running. We had a 100 million square feet nationally and 100 office buildings, Class A office buildings around the country offering in-building phone service. MFS bought us pre-1996 Telecom Act. And when I came to this event 3 years ago, I bumped into a lot of my old friends who were in the fiber business back in the first wave with CCI and MFS and Brooks and all those guys. So for me, it's really nice, kind of like a coming home week to come to this event. But I think the topic today is the intersection of wireless and wireline. And the first question is, are wireless technologies going to replace some of the existing wireline technologies, or are they a complement? And we'll just go down the and if you, how's it changing your business, frankly?
Well, I mean, I think when you begin to talk about wireline and wireless, you're talking about two things, and you're talking about with wireless capacity and spectrum. And I think that to achieve the broadband objectives that have been set for the future in terms of the amount of broadband capacity that is going to be delivered to the typical end user, and later on in rural areas, which have other complications, the issue really becomes anytime that you have a wireless network and you're going to increase your broadband capacity, it carries significant costs associated with it. So wireline has been incorporated by these firms because it is the most economical and cost-efficient way to do broadband delivery, especially with optical backhaul. So I see wireline and wireless as being integrated together in a way that they can't really be separated. So I don't think one supplants the other. I think they complement each other, and I think that they actually are so dependent on each other that we could honestly say that you're not going to have a high-capacity wireless network of the future without strong wireline support behind it. If you look right now, I saw an interesting statistic this morning with the growth of video. Every minute of the day in the United States, there are 300,000 photos and videos sent. Every minute of the day, that's 216 million photos and videos sent in a 24-hour period. And I guess it's Nielsen's law says that the high-end users of data are going to grow exponentially by 50% year over year.
I will not tell my kids, but right. I think most of those photos are from my kids and their friends.
They might be. So if you extrapolate that out and say that 50% of these are high-end users whose capacity is going to grow 50% year over year, I mean, now we're into, 400 million images. And that, the need for video puts such a stress on the network that it exhausts the capacity of existing networks very easily. So I think therein wireline is critical to supporting that.
And Felipe, this is your third run in building a network here in NYC. So maybe you should think about this question, talk about the generational differences in your wireline technologies that's being shaped by the demands on the wireless side.
Sure. Look, I mean, I agree with Hugh. I mean, they're highly complementary. There's a boundary condition, in which case some will be replaced by another, but it's a very narrow boundary condition. The what makes a wireless interesting, not only from a carrier perspective, but also from an end-user perspective, is the mobility, right? What makes fiber interesting is the fact that high capacity, but it's fixed to the ground. So it's a marriage, a highly complementary marriage of the two. The challenges that come along with that is really how do you manage the, one is the increased requirement for high quality of service and transmission at the wireless level in urban environments like New York. And there's three ways to do it. I mean, you increase spectrum, which is costly, it takes a long time, and it's not always available. You go to new technology like 5G, but in some cases, I mean, I think you got to finish up with the previous versions of technology before you get to that. And that's, again, it's an economic and lead time issue. And then you have infrastructure. And this was something that came up at the wireless, the New York State Wireless Forum last week on Wednesday. I mean, addressing the, it's almost an oxymoron that infrastructure seems to be the fastest way to allow for an increase in penetration of wireless, an increase of granularity of being able to deliver that bandwidth for video, photos, and everything else, the Internet of Everything that's happening out there. And that means that fiber has to be driven very, very deeply into the urban environment to enable small cell, micro cell, and all of the new infrastructure architecture developments that whether it's the wireless infrastructure carriers or the actual carriers are deploying. So that's where the two marry very conveniently. And one of the rationales for us launching this business, which is putting even more fiber into New York, is the fact that we see that as a very large driver for fiber demand and penetration, with a caveat that it's a very different type of architecture and deployment than most of us know from a carrier perspective. So it's a challenge. It's going to be interesting, but definitely complementary, not antagonistic. I don't think the two can live without the other.
Greg?
Yeah, so I agree with both gentlemen. I think even beyond complementary, they're symbiotic. I think, to your final point, they can't survive without one another. If you think about, usage patterns, everywhere we used to use wired networks, whether that was in the workplace or anywhere, it's all wireless from a user perspective, right? I mean, I have my iMac sitting on my desk at home next to a network jack in the wall, and I'm on Wi-Fi, right? I don't even think about getting an Ethernet cord and plugging it in. And I think that trend applies everywhere. So that last connection is wireless. So that demand for wireless, that demand for that wireless connection is stimulating the need for more robust wireline networks. And vice versa, more robust wireline networks are enabling the ability to push wireless everywhere. And whether that's, and we'll get into a little later in the conversation, whether that's small cells or macro cells or whatever the case may be, there's this symbiotic relationship now that I think was starting to become more apparent 5 years ago, but these days it's one's not going to exist without the other.
Greg, Hugh mentioned earlier mobile video and video streaming. I think GASA is actually, with Periscope, you're streaming this to the world. Talk about what impact mobile video is having on wireless, wireline, and even the co-location fiber infrastructure world.
Sure, from a wireless perspective, it's bringing networks to their knees, right? They were originally designed to handle voice calls, really basic voice calls. And then obviously texting came, demand grew and then data and now video. There are finite resources in wireless. You've got spectrum constraints, and that's not the only resource. You've also got the ability to site cell sites, whether it's small, medium, or large cell. You've got regulatory constraints, environmental constraints, real estate constraints. You've got all kinds of constraints on the wireless side that make it really difficult to satisfy this growing capacity demand from video. So, carriers are having to rethink how they engineer and operate their networks in today, with the demand curve that's coming up. So I think, we've talked about the growing demand of video, and you've got, Verizon and others looking at LTE broadcast, which is, an interesting technology. It's not clear if there's a business case for it, but it's certainly one means of reducing the demands on the wireless networks of video. But there's a wholesale shift coming in how carriers are operating and deploying their networks, because they simply, none of them have enough spectrum, and even if they did, they don't have enough sites, and they don't have enough backhaul capacity, and they don't have, frankly, enough revenue, right? There's the bottom line is, all of this demand for video, everybody sitting and watching YouTube or whatever, or sharing videos on Facebook or whatever it is. I'm sure my kids know all of their apps that I don't use, but there's no incremental revenue to the wireless carrier. So you're seeing the trends, the ARPU trends are going down while the network demands are going up, and something's got to give, right? So until there's a meaningful incremental, revenue opportunity for the carriers, whether that's, LTE broadcast or it's some types of sponsored data or something, it's going to be really tough to keep up.
And Felipe, you launched your service in January this year, mobile video. How'd you build that into your business plan?
It wasn't really about mobile video. It was more about looking at the demand trends overall. I mean, I think mobile video is the current driver for all of this file sharing and so on and so forth. But if you step back for a second, if you think about the Internet of Everything, right, which right now could mean, I don't know who wants to know what the refrigerator is doing in the middle of the day, but eventually all of that tiny data will amass itself into an avalanche of data that's going to eclipse probably the video driver anyway. So we looked at it and said, well, what is the underlying basic block actually that allows that all that wireless traffic to actually connect to what we call the mainstream network, if you will, and inter-exchange all that traffic between points not only in New York but then across the globe and so on and so forth. So one of the drivers was wireless expansion. I think sort of like tempered a little bit by the fact that as you mentioned, as Greg mentioned, you know, where's the revenue, right? How do the carriers make money out of this thing? And, you know, kind of goes back to the old Ethernet and Sonnet challenge, right? You know, Ethernet came out clearly a more efficient technology, but the adoption rate for Ethernet over Sonnet, I mean, has taken, I don't know, at least a decade. So I think the challenge is not going to be demand. I think it's the timing of demand as these new architectures and deployments, infrastructure upgrades roll out, driven primarily by the economics. If something works well, you have to make a major investment to take it out and deploy something new. I mean, you know, carriers will ask the hard question, where is the money in this thing? And part of it, they may be driven to it by quality, and they start exchanging end users and go back to the beginning where they were fighting over end users, and it won't be over price. It might be more over quality of transmission than anything else.
Mm-hmm. That's a great segue. Hugh, talk about your business and how mobile video is impacting these different
segments. Well, I'm just going to piggyback on his observation and say that in addition to where the money is, where is the technology innovation that's going to achieve some of these needed improvements in managing the available spectrum? I think the CTIA noted that if you could manage all of the spectrum in the United States, it wouldn't be equal to the capacity of a strand of fiber. And so right there, it sort of encapsulates the issue from a spectrum standpoint. And to gain greater efficiencies over the available spectrums that they have, let's use Verizon as an example. I think nationwide, their average is about 116 megahertz in most markets. That is not considered adequate, okay, even in urban areas, to meet the demands that are going to be placed on the network with all of the need for video and other applications. So there's only so much spectrum at the moment till the government releases more, you know, as they try to do. But the question really becomes, there's some technologies that are in the offering, but they're not here necessarily yet that could improve the use of the spectrum. But it's a real challenge, and the challenge is the demands on the network going to outpace their ability to be able to come up with ways to utilize the networks and the spectrum more efficiently. So I think that's a big concern.
And the next question, Felipe, we'll start with you. When you talk about this high-quality video and you think about the segment of the market you serve, of the cable companies and the mobile operators and the wireline operators, how has the quality of video, demand or need for quality of video, affected or changed the way you architect your network here in New York City?
I'm not a wireless expert, so I can't really address the front end of it. But from a fiber networking perspective, I mean, I think it just continues to drive the need to deeply deploy fiber into the environment, right? So you're talking about, unfortunately, you know, the economic challenge is that most of these sites will need only preferably a strand of fiber, but a pair at the most. So that's our challenge, right? I mean, how do we make it happen economically? But it continues to drive the having to make fiber available very deeply, almost to just about every building, and buildings that in the past we as fiber builders would not have considered attractive buildings. So I call it Class B and C real estate, not to be, you know, insulting to anyone, but the reality is the smaller buildings, 5-story buildings, 10-story buildings, areas that previously were only served, or let's say they were underserved from a fiber provider perspective, very little or no choice except the incumbent and maybe a cable company, that both which did not want to sell dark fiber. So that's our ability as a community of fiber builders to drive that fiber deeply into the environment, basically the geography, enables then a lot of the technological advances, or in some cases it may just actually enable the process of rolling out new advances at the edge, which would be the wireless architecture. So it's a very simple You know, it's very black and white. I mean, there isn't a lot of nebulousness about it. I mean, we got to put fiber deeply into the urban environment.
And again, continuing in that vein, Felipe, you know, in the early days of, again, when I was at Metropolitan Fiber Systems, it was pretty easy to do the network planning. You knew where the T1s were. You knew which buildings were dense and needed DS3s or gigabit type service, and you could plan your route accordingly. Today, with the organic nature of wireless networks, where you have an ebb and flow of traffic throughout the day, and you mentioned Internet of Things, where you may not know where the demand is going to come from. With telemedicine might be enabled, and NYU all of a sudden might need a lot of bandwidth at a small center. So when it comes back to your core architecture, conduits, number of strands in each conduit, split points for these minimal laterals, how is that a challenge to plan for, or do you have that covered?
This is a conversation we have daily. I look back in the room, you know, Patty Polo, who heads anything that has to do with making things happen on Axiom Anywhere, we have this conversation every day. How do we do this? How do we make sure that it's efficient enough in the network deployment that we can take advantage and serve the needs of multiple customers, potential customers and sectors? Look, at the core, you have to have a very strong backbone network that enables you to, that gets you close to just about every location you want to serve. So that's the approach we're taking, and that's a traditional fiber network, high count. The second principle is it's almost, you put as much fiber as you can stuff into the available conduit, because you never know, you know, when you're going to have availability of conduit, in the, certainly Manhattan and in New York City. The second aspect of it is you take a chance in many cases as to where you drop off some of the stub out fibers to serve certain sections of the geography. And you have to admit to yourselves that you're going to be wrong. Almost no matter what you do, you're going to be right in some cases, you're going to be wrong in others. But that's okay, because you know the wireless industry itself doesn't know, let's say, where they're going with some of these deployments. They just know they'll need fiber, they'll need it quickly, and they'll only need a couple of pairs here and there in multiple buildings. So it's a challenge. I think the other aspect of the challenge, which has to do with, and I'll deal with Manhattan specifically, is the Empire City Subway system, which is a conduit system that as a franchise holder you're allowed to use. It is built on a what we call the early 1900s model, right? And this is an industry issue. To deliver services in a very linear, very well-planned kind of environment. So there's not a lot of options on how do you get off that system, you know, efficiently to drive small fiber requirements on a single unit basis, not on aggregate. So we're working through that, and it's just not just us, anyone who's building a fiber network in New York. And the challenge, part of the challenge is also dealing with the economics the city of New York imposes through the franchise, which is not, doesn't provide an incentive for deep fiber deployment. And that's something that I think will change, hopefully in the short term, but that'll help essentially incent us to drive fiber deeper. And it's an economic incentive, which is not there right now.
Yeah. Greg, any comments on the network architecture driven by the need or potential need for quality video?
Yeah, I mean, from a wireless perspective, we said, you know, you've got spectrum constraints. So you're forced to, you know, we call cell splitting or network densification, smaller and smaller cells to reuse spectrum more and more often. You can only do that up to a certain point. And you've got cost constraints as well, as I mentioned earlier. So, yeah, I mean, the demands, you know, video and, you know, other demands are certainly driving the need for that densification. You know, availability of fiber is a challenge. You know, right now, you know, small cells take many forms, but a lot of carriers have taken the approach to, of pushing fiber to all their small cells. You know, haven't pursued, you know, at least haven't deployed much in the way of alternatives, whether using, you know, legacy copper networks, non-line of sight or line of sight microwave or other options or mesh type networks. So, you know, availability of fiber is certainly a challenge, but, you know, the architecture is evolving. It's turning into many thousands or hundreds of thousands of sites instead of tens of thousands of sites. And I think, take it a step further, ultimately, that content is going to need to be pushed further out to the network as well. It's something the wireless carriers aren't very good at, I would say, generally. It's not an area they've played in the past. They just built delivery mechanisms, but now they need to get to content delivery mechanisms. And that's, I think that's a trend that we're going to see. Certainly the MSOs have a lot of experience with that. I think we're going to see the wireless carriers start to get a whole lot smarter in that area as well and start to push this content for closer to the edge of their networks.
Can you paint a picture what in terms of what that looks like?
Not yet.
So some of the commentary I've been hearing is that you'll actually have mobile operators almost at the cell tower putting in some sort of blade server, very
right.
low-cost server, which becomes the content delivery network. And so ideally that would push more than two strands of fiber maybe, or at least diverse
yeah.
fiber, because you got to deliver on the Netflix stream. But do you have any insights in terms of hypothetically what that new architecture might look like?
Yeah, it's a much more virtualized network, to begin with, to allow the ability to move capacity around. But you're right, this could be pushing as far as the edge of the network all the way to the macro sites. It's certainly a challenge when you start getting to small cells, which by the very nature need to be small, portable, easy to deploy and install. But pushing servers, as far out into the network as possible can dramatically improve the overall performance of the network, as well as the experience of the end user. So, what that architecture looks like is still, in labs and in theory and in design phase on the wireless side. I mean, as I said, the wireline side's been doing that for a lot of years, and the MSOs have certainly been, is with a more predictable demand scenario than the wireless companies have really gotten good at pushing that content to the edge of the network.
Well, and maybe you can help me answer this question. So right now, the hot trend in wireless networks is network function virtualization, software-defined networks, which is really bringing all that network functionality to the cloud.
Right.
And at the same time, they need to push more hardware to the edge. So what is that really good? What's that mean?
Yeah, no, it's a good question. And I think the virtualization of the network, you see the AT&Ts and the Verizon of the world certainly recognizing that that's the long-term trend. And they need to balance kind of that central processing and pushing the intelligence to the center of the network with this need to push the content to the edge of the network. So not a trivial undertaking, particularly as you try and, sounds disparaging, but you try and make the devices at the edge of the network a little dumber, right? So that you can distribute capacity, you can get a little bit smarter in how you allocate resources across your network. It also allows for the operations and management of that edge network to be a lot more efficient, a lot more effective. So it's certainly going to be a challenge to accomplish both of those objectives. It'd be interesting to see over the next decade how that plays out. We're at the very, very, we're at the first inning of network virtualization on the wireless side, the very first inning.
So Hugh, what's your commentary? We talked about the demand for video at the edge, storage at the edge. From a management standpoint, what's this going to mean to the carriers?
Well, to be honest with you, it's 25 years at AT&T. I can kick in with my two cents that there has to be always a strong ROI scenario
yep.
for them to do a build. I'm not so sure, if you look at it from a carrier perspective, but if you begin to look at it from a business demographic perspective across the United States and how much medium-sized businesses there are in the U.S. and where they're located. Are these people who are we going to wind up with a have-have-not situation where it just isn't worth it? As Felipe was saying, from an ROI standpoint for the carriers to do certain builds into certain areas to deliver that capability that makes businesses more competitive. Okay, so I mean, from our perspective, does that have a social implication to us if we don't deliver to them a higher bandwidth capability because of the constraints economically to do so?
Got it. Well, RCR Wireless, we write a lot about a term called densification, small cell densification, Wi-Fi offload, heterogeneous networks. And as you start looking at the network topography to support a dense network, I'd like to talk a little bit about where's the head end going to go? And let me give you some background here. So 2 years ago, AT&T announced they were going to build 40,000 small cells. I don't think they realized that dream. But when you're a carrier and you start to planning out this densification of your network, you're looking at securing right-of-ways, pole attachment agreements, small antennas or radio units on a light tower or a light lamppost, and then you got to bring it back to a centralized head-end. So as we look at, you can either co-locate in a Bell CO, you can go to an existing co-location center, or I guess the question is, will you see a new neutral host head-end start to arise, and with room for 10 years of growth, because if AT&T, Verizon, T-Mobile are going to build a dense network with, Greg, you mentioned lots and lots more of, instead of going 300,000 cell sites, you might have a million plus cell sites, and all that's going to come together. I'll tell you, whoever wants to take the question, I'd love to hear about, you know, where's the centralized headed going to be in these markets?
Yeah, so it's a great question because, you know, so far what we've seen is the carriers, as they're building small cells, they've used their existing macro sites as the head end effectively. And when I talk about small cells, not necessarily talking about distributed antenna systems, DAS systems, which require a fairly robust head end.
Oh, that's a good point. On the in-building DAS systems, they are building a head end at the basement of the building, but all of a sudden you can't afford to build 100 of those in Manhattan.
Right, that's exactly right. So, you know, a lot of times you're seeing the carriers bringing via fiber, dark fiber in a lot of cases, the traffic back to a macro site and putting the processing at a serving macro site, at a macro site that's close by. That model works generally pretty well if you can get dark fiber back to the macro. And that's, you know, that's certainly been a challenge. You know, the embedded players, some of the large embedded players are reluctant to provide dark fiber in those scenarios. They certainly want to provide the lit service and escalate that over time. You know, some of the upstarts, some of the newer providers in the marketplace, and you know, folks that have been much more willing to provide dark fiber type services. So, you know, there's an alternative here that I think the carriers are going to be exploring and have already started to explore, and that's actually using their network for backhaul. So you've got these small cell devices out there, and they're in an area with sufficient coverage, but maybe without sufficient capacity. So actually hopping from small cell to small cell wirelessly, whether it's mesh or it's a non-line of sight microwave, and aggregating at a small cell and taking it back to a macro site or taking it back to a head end somewhere else. So I think what we're going to see is all different types of architectures dictated by spectrum availability, whether that's licensed or unlicensed spectrum, the specifics of the environment, whether you can get line of sight or not, the availability of fiber, the ability to put to centralize head ends in, whether it's, you know, neutral hosted locations or existing data centers. I don't think there's going to be a one size fits all is the long and short of it. You're going to see a really diverse set of solutions from dense urban to suburban, ex-urban, rural. You can see all types of solutions.
And we'll just go right down the line, Felipe.
Yeah. I think Greg captured a very good snapshot. As we look at this and as the discussion progresses here, I mean, it's sort of like I made some notes because you're going to see just from a very practical perspective, probably the large colo model, if you will. I think it's, I'm not predicting the demise of the colo model. But you're going to see micro.
You heard it first here.
Yeah. The large, maybe the demise of their of how they charge money to be in there. But that's a different topic for a different panel. Look, at the end of the day, I think one of the solutions, it will be a micro colo sites. I mean, non-traditional deployments of centralized locations that may or may not be owned by a single carrier, that may or may not be part of a CDN and hubbing architecture, but you're going to find them in locations that non-traditional locations. It could be in some of these sort of a class B and C real estate because the real estate may be more open to doing that kind of solution and enabled by fiber providers like us to capture traffic and more efficient than backhauling everything back to a central large point. And that's something different than, you know, I heard it discussed in terms of for small cell deployment, but the reality is that it should go beyond that, right? And encompass other things like the CDN, right? To enable more of the streaming, more economically, you know, you've got a lot of companies doing that now, wired basically anyway. So I think that's an interesting development, actually, which obviously will drive more business for me.
And you mentioned B and C rated buildings, if you will, in terms of demand. How about the tier 2, 3, and 4 markets? Do you see, what sort of trends do you see? And this is unscripted here, but we've been talking a lot about New York City, but how about the next tier and third tier and fourth tier markets? What do you see happening in those markets?
This is based on discussions we've had with wireless infrastructure companies, how they're looking at not only their urban environment, but also outside of that. Certainly tier 2, it'll get to tier 2, but it seems like the amount of traffic that's in those locations obviously is less. And the ability to probably put more traditional infrastructure in place is still sufficient. So I don't see them at least from their perspective, they're not immediate requirements. But like everything else, I mean, if you see the trend in an environment like New York, I mean, or a dense metro environment, that it's only a matter of time before that moves on to the next, to the second tier, tier two. But it's not a, again, based on our conversations with those companies, I mean, they're looking at these years down the road. You know, their immediate focus is how do we handle situations like New York, Chicago, places where there's a very dense urban environment. And it's not the density of the urbanity of it. It's really more of the traffic density, which is driven by the amount of people. I mean, it's just a very simple equation. Mm-hmm.
So, Hugh, any comments on the centralized head-end or co-location facilities and then the second, no, third-tier markets?
Are far better to address that than I am.
But, Greg, I saw you nodding your head on the second-tier, third-tier, fourth-tier markets.
Yeah, I think it's a good point. The you said AT&T mentioned several years back they were going to deploy 40,000 small cells. They didn't just decide not to do it. They couldn't do it because the business case didn't work. And if the business case doesn't work in places like Manhattan, which it's a challenge here, it's not, right? With all the demand that you've got here, the business case for small cells is difficult to justify. They're expensive to deploy right now. If it didn't work here with this kind of demand, it doesn't work in the tier twos, tier threes, tier fours, except in maybe very specific pockets. So I think it's really comes down to the business case. We come back to that point a number of times, but prices have got to come down dramatically from a capital and a recurring OPEX perspective in order to make the business case work, even in the tier one markets.
And you're talking about small cells specifically. So what are some of the, when you look at what are the hurdles, what are the specific hurdles? Is it securing the right of ways? Is it the recurring cost of what the rent they have to pay on a pole? What is it? Is it the technology or all the above?
Yes, all the above. I mean, so take technology off the table for just a moment. The carriers historically have deployed 3,000 to 6,000 macro sites a year, and they're built to deploy those types of macro sites. They're familiar and comfortable with the regulatory environment, the zoning, the environmental process. They're very comfortable with engaging with landlords. And the real estate side of it is matured on the tower side. As you know, you've got a small number of companies that own a big percentage of the towers. It makes it really efficient to deploy macro sites. All those things that make it efficient to deploy macro sites make it really inefficient to deploy small cells. Single carrier locations, disaggregated real estate environment, not large structures with real estate where you can bring fiber to. It's, you know, all those challenges are there. So finding a location that you can engage a landlord and get a low rent. You can get through environmental and, you know, every other regulatory review that's going to be possible, whether it's a conservancy board or just a municipality. Dealing with the handout requests, you know, oh, you're going to install something there? I'd like you to replace the pole, pour a new foundation, put a street light in, add this, add that, right? Gets expensive. Availability of backhaul. And is there fiber? Can we get fiber there affordably? Availability of commercial power. Not a challenge to be overlooked. And then once you've gotten through past all those hurdles, you still have to get this to integrate cleanly into your network, where a user can hand off to the macro and hand back to the small cell. So, yes, it's all of the above. You know, from equipment all the way through the siting, leasing, zoning, environmentals, all of it. It's a challenge from top to bottom. And we're going from spending $200,000 on a macro site to trying to get small cells down to $10,000 a piece. And that is a significant undertaking, particularly when the folks that are trying to do it are the folks that have been building $200,000 macros for the last 25 years. So their mindset is very much elsewhere.
Okay. Well, we're coming up. I'd like to wrap up with kind of a fast-paced question here, two-part question. Will we ever see small cell deployments? That's a yes or no. And if you say yes, when? And so, Hugh, we'll start with you.
To be honest with you, my expertise is not in small cell technology, so I think Greg and Felipe probably can do justice to it better than I can.
So will we see small cell deployments in volume? If so, when?
Yes. I mean, it's happening now. It's just nascent, right? So I think I would take the typical projection and cut it in half, and that will give a good time frame. So I think it'll probably hit the stride in probably about 36 months or so.
Yeah. Greg?
Yeah, I think that's right. I think we're starting to see some momentum. But you can probably chop a zero off of any of the forecasts you see, because there's so many technological and deployment management hurdles that we still have to get past. So it'll happen. It'll happen where it makes business sense, and it'll happen with one fewer zeros.
Okay. Why don't we open up for some audience questions? And Yes, sir. State your name,
Hi,
company.
Smith at Lenning ACM. This is a contractor with Greg. Wi-Fi. Every time I talk to you about it, there's technical issues, but we all do it at home. It's very effective. Where the boundaries are very
So let's repeat the question. So it's for everybody. We got Fedor Smith, Atlantic ACM, asked a question about Wi-Fi offload to Greg.
So number one, is there a business case for it, right? Can the carriers justify the investment in that tight integration? And on the provider side, whoever's providing the Wi-Fi network, is there a business case for them to actually charge for it? So that hasn't fully shaken out. The second thing is, while you've obviously had a positive experience on the data side, on the voice side, it's not nearly as favorable of an experience. And that's a challenge for the wireless carriers, because you walk into a Starbucks or McDonald's and you don't have macro network coverage maybe, but you have Wi-Fi. The typical end user, we're a fairly technologically advanced group in this room, I'd say, on average. But the typical end user, if you make it truly seamless, where they can, now they're on Wi-Fi and now they can, browse the web, stream video, they also want to be able to pick up their phone and make a call. And when they walk out of that restaurant, they want to be able to not drop that call. That seamless integration has been a challenge for the carriers. And it hasn't, it's an area where T-Mobile's probably invested the most, kind of by necessity because of their overall macro network and what their coverage profile looks like. So there are absolutely technological hurdles. It's uncomfortable for the wireless carriers because it's a network quality that they no longer control. You're outside of their environment. They're not managing that access point. They don't control the real estate underneath it. They don't control the backhaul agreement. So there's a lot of non-technical challenges in addition to the technical challenges that you're aware of.
Any other questions? Question.
So, Ralph's Crossroad Fiber. Is the wireless space at this point really all about small cell and DAS, basically supporting the cellular carriers? Or over the years, people have launched and failed and launched again, wireless broadband businesses. It's point-to-point, point-to-multi-point, and they never seem to work. Maybe some of the point-to-point on the very high end, but that's about it. Or just, anybody's thoughts as to whether this will, at some point, become a viable business model, given not just expense of fiber in every building. Is that an alternative that someone's going to be able to make work?
Look, I'll take a first crack at answering that from a very practical perspective. Small cell is viable. I mean, it's happening now, but it's still in what I call the hype stage. This is just, bluntly speaking, there's a lot of talk about this is going on, that's going on, we're going to deploy, like Greg said. I mean, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of this deployments for this. It's starting to hit reality. It'll hit reality. That's why I said eventually, probably in about 3 years, I mean, you're going to start seeing a realistic movement, in that direction. It's viable, if anything, because
small
they'll
small
be.
Cell, but on the outside, the sort of cellular around, somebody having a business model saying, hey, instead of getting a fiber pair or 100 meg circuit from the carrier, some alternative wireless provider to do something like that. Is that something that people foresee really work?
It's been tried again. And it's still being tried now, right? You've got the partnership between, was it Dish and Sprint and some markets in Texas where they're trying it on a residential basis using Sprint's 2.5 spectrum. Spectrum is one of the constraints. The ability to provide a service like that at high capacity potentially require a decent amount of spectrum and potentially to control quality doing it in a licensed band. So Sprint, who holds a lot of 2.5, is probably a good candidate for that. But it's a very different business model, right? And it's a very challenging business model, highly fragmented customer base who aren't walking into retail stores or ordering from the carrier website. So, I think all the carriers, the wireless carriers, have dabbled in that space at various points. But the lack of trucks to roll to your home or to an office building to do the Dish install and optimize it and manage that customer relationship, I think nobody's really thrown their weight behind it. There's been a lot of technology trials, but the business case for the return on investment for traditional wireless handsets and devices is just too good, and that's where they're keeping that's where they're putting their capital dollars right now. So that's where you start to see, with a Dish T-Mobile or a Dish Sprint or a company or DirecTV AT&T, where they've got a field force, they've got you know, folks that have interacted with customers on site, can install equipment on site, whether it's a residence or an office building, starts to get a little more interesting because they can get over some of those operational hurdles. It's a question of what it'll those will be competing for capital dollars just like against the wireless networks.
Another question.
Yeah, I'm curious. If the carriers need Wi-Fi offload, first of all, why wouldn't they just build it themselves? TowerStream talks a lot about this Wi-Fi offload. Curious if what you guys know about them, or is there anything happening?
Yeah, I don't know anything about the TowerStream model.
No, I do not.
Why don't they build themselves? I mean, it's
it's
not dissimilar from building small cells all over the place. So that's I think what we're going to see over the years is that these small cells are ultimately multimode devices supporting Wi-Fi. In a lot of cases, when you're walking to a restaurant office building, that's one of the sales points to try and get low or no rent type of scenario is maybe offering Wi-Fi to folks in the building. So I think you'll see there'll be some convergence on that side, but. You know, all the same challenges exist in deploying wireless Wi-Fi access points as deploying small cells.
Yes, sir.
Hi, Rob Bodioso with Snyder & Snyder. I guess this is from Ms. Alvarez. What are your biggest challenges in New York City? Is it the franchising? Is it permitting and construction? Maybe it's maintaining the networks and DDC, workout orders and stuff like that. What are your biggest challenges here in New York?
Everything. Nothing is easy in New York. But some things have gotten easier. Franchising is really not an issue. I mean, the city has made that very, very structured. They have a method to the craziness. I mean, which will peak at a few years when all the franchise basically ends. Coterminous, and so we'll see what happens there. So that's not an issue. I think the economics of the franchise are an issue. That's something that the people it doesn't encourage deep deployment. Essentially, it's a linear. Per foot charge per year, and it doesn't matter how much you deploy, whether you do 1 foot or you do a million feet, it's the same charge. So the construction side of it, I mean, it's some things have gotten worse since I last did this in the, maybe 5-6 years ago. The capacity of the conduit system is difficult. There are sections that are congested. There's no relief in sight for that, so it forces you to actually find workarounds. So it's still viable, but it's gotten a little more difficult. I think the largest hurdle is an economic hurdle, and not necessarily on the street or the construction costs or anything like that. It was fairly stable. I mean, I think some of the real estate, the landlords, have gotten, very savvy as to how to handle telecom folks. So the economics have changed deeply. I mean, and things that in the past were seen as an amenity to the tenant base now are being charged for. So we're getting charged significant amounts of money, to be in certain buildings. And I think that's it's good for the landlords, I suppose. I don't think it's so good for the tenants, prospective tenants, and overall for the city. That doesn't really lead to a better infrastructure. But if you tie it all together, I mean, I had spoken of construction of a fiber network in New York City. It's a very carefully orchestrated dance. We know how to do it. The people we work with know how to do it. So it happens. The dance comes off well. But it sort of like underestimates, to the trained eye. I mean, you know what's going on, but to the untrained eye, I mean, it's difficult. It speaks to you need to work with folks that actually know how to do it, have experience through this thing.
Okay, another question here.
Chris Tripp, Consult Solutions Group. You guys talk about Wi-Fi being difficult to deploy as far as the carriers using it for offload and such. It seems as though the MSOs have figured that out, right? They've got a pretty dense Wi-Fi coverage, especially in urban areas. Do you see any commingling of those two groups to sort of solve the Wi-Fi problem?
Yeah, I think they're all dancing, but not exactly sure if they like one another as partners, right? Certainly the MSOs have figured it out because they have a wireline network to plug them into. And relationships with, whether it's the residences or the businesses. So they've got a serious leg up. They're also a potential partner on the small cell side. When you look at, maybe not Manhattan, but you go all over the country and they've got strands attached to utility poles, and those strands have power, those strands have backhaul. They've already got the right-of-way agreements. They potentially bring, we talk about the concept of small cells as a service. They are a very interesting partner for the wireless carriers. But on the other hand, they also provide a lot of macro site backhaul to the carriers. So they're very concerned about cannibalizing that existing business because the price structure, as I mentioned, has to be very different for small cells than it does for macros. And they're just waiting for the day when they dramatically drop the price of fiber to a small cell for the first carrier to raise their hand and say, I got a macro site two blocks away. Why is that one costing me four times as much? So there's some, you know, kind of strategic challenges the parties need to get past. But they are, that relationship, I think we're going to see over time, yeah, potentially some mergers, but certainly some deeper partnerships.
So yeah, I'm from Austin, Texas, and last week I'm going to do an informal poll, people in the audience and some of the panelists here. But Jonathan Adelstein, who is a former FCC commissioner, he's CEO of the Wireless Infrastructure Association. He spoke last week at the New York State Wireless Association, and there was a big headline, "Wireless New York City, the wireless envy of the world." So I'm curious, do folks here think that New York City is the wireless envy of the world? Does anybody get good signal here? So, you know, why aren't you getting good signals and good service in New York City? Anybody want to take that?
This is not an easy place. I mean, this is not, you know, we talked about the challenges of small cells, but just from a macro perspective, look at the last 20 years, it's been macro sites. I mean, this is a tough, look outside. How do you cover the ground and the 80th floor of these buildings? How do you do it in a way dealing with pretty sophisticated landlords, high construction costs, union labor? I mean, this is a confluence of of everything that you know, when you talk about the risks of deployment, that, you know, that one risk slide could apply to, you know, entirely to New York City. So it shouldn't be such a great wireless experience here, I would say, based on the environment.
Anybody else want to comment on the New York City being the wireless envy of the world?
I think it depends what carrier you use.
So are you going to go on record today on who's the best carrier? In addition to the demise of co-location, we're going to get additional comments. Well, let's give the speakers a big round of applause. Thank you so much.